You're now under the sounds of the voice of deprogram enlightener, Kahan Tazadaq, the most intellectualized channel on YouTube, among various topics, giving you right knowledge for real. This is your housework. That's how we on it. Like, share, subscribe.
Shalom. Once again, it's the voice of Brother Tazadaq, coming at you as usual, through the Spirit of the Most High in Christ. For the record, I'd like to reserve all of my rights. Federal Republic. This is not legal advice. I did not offer legal advice. This is for entertainment, educational, and informational purposes only. If you need legal advice, seek yourself a competent attorney and please be advised. Should you decide to use any of this information and fall flat on your face, it is your own fault because you did not research the information that you heard. Trust no one and research everything thoroughly. I wanted to speak briefly about redemption. A lot of people talking about redeeming themselves, the redemption process. What is redemption? What does it mean to you? Well, from the Zondervan Practitioner Encyclopedia for the Bible, some of you might know what the Bible means. Other of you are so off track and so damn satanic and caught up into the theory of evolution that you totally denounce the Bible. But that's another story, and that's part of what's wrong with the society. You're morally, like, starved. You're immoral. You're morally starved. So redemption, what is it? Redemption is the deliverance from the power for alien dominion and the enjoyment for resulting freedom. So it actually involves the ideal of restoration, to restore for one who possesses a fundamental right for entrance. Excuse me. Now, the best example of redemption that I could possibly think of is Yahshua Allah, the children of Israel, during the time of the Bible. The children of Israel was in bondage, serving rigorous hard labor to the pharaohs in Egypt for 430 years of hard bondage. The pharaoh did not want to allow the children of Israel to go because he was benefiting off of their free labor. Today's pharaohs, or your lawyers, your judges, they pull you back and forth to these courts like chattel. And they're profiting off of our ignorance. So we must have deliverance. While you're waiting on the Mashiach, what do you intend to do? Just sit there and be slaves and take the punishment, withstand all that Satan's angels have to throw at you? So the deliverance for the children of Israel must begin now. You are the children of Israel. Now, if the Bible was just written as a book of the past, of ancient stories, then it has no relevance today. But if we could actually utilize the Bible as an example, and it was written yesterday with today in mind, and things that would come to pass, then we must actually look around and look for the parallel of the children of Israel. So, while you endure this hard bondage, you need to learn how the game is being played. Then you could actually better play the game, if you want to play the game at all, on the court or in the court. So the children of Israel needs to be freed from bondage, from the dominion of alien powers, currently known as public officials or foreign agents, for entertainment purposes. So, when we look at the book of Luke 24 and 21, Israel needed to be freed from the rule of the Romans. This American form of government is an extension of the Roman Empire. But what is redemption? In reference to the United States, redemption for us is capturing that strawman. You can't own it because you did not create it, but you can capture it, you could copyright it. So it's the actually transmitting utility from the natural living soul for the corporation or the commercial or third party entity that they have actually turned you into using a birth certificate, using a state birth certificate to turn you into a corporation with four capital names, creating a corporate fiction that's actually appearing to be your given name at birth when you are the natural person. So as a pledge for your energy and surety for any change made against that straw man. So how do you free yourself from this? How do you get freedom? Freedom comes with the filing of various documents revoking powers of attorneys, i.e. UCC-1, and various other documents. But you say, how can you free yourself? And this is what many people have actually asked. If I'm submitting paper to the government, am I not still giving them rule over me? No, what you've done, you consent by actually signing documents, so you go back and you undo what you've done. That's why it's known as a revoking the power of attorney. So don't listen to those people that's telling you, be they Moors or whoever, telling you, well, filing these papers against the government's not going to do anything. You're not filing papers against the government. You're trying to unravel what has been done over the years. You know, you went and signed out for a social security card. You said consented. You consented to every type of contract. Now you have to rescind such contracts. You revoke the power of attorney, given any third party power of attorney over you. So freedom comes with the filing of various paperwork to include the UCC-1 against that straw man. And subsequently, the acceptance for value when applied correctly for that state birth certificate that your mother informed over you. And so on and so forth. For all of these, throughout these union states. And thereby actually making you the surety and the guarantor for and against the strawman. So, I mean, the redemption process is not that complicated when actually applied correctly. So, I mean, I briefly put in videos how did this thing start and so on and so forth, and went into a little history, you know, about various topics. Many people are starting to pick up. A lot of people all around the world are actually starting to wake up because information that's been surfacing. And may the people continue to wake up. Shalom. Shalom, brothers and sisters, once again. It's the voice of Tyler Doc. Today's date is January the 3rd, according to their calendar, 2012. For the record, this is not legal advice. I did not offer legal advice. This is for educational, informational, entertainment purposes only. If you need legal advice, seek yourself a competent attorney and please be advised. Should you decide to use this information to fall flat on your face, it is your own fault because you did not research the information that was stated herein. With that being said, I wanted to talk to you a little more about redemption and why, how,
When? Where? You know, why do we even need redemption? Well, let me tell you a story. Our story begins in the 13 original colonies with the forming of the United States. Now, the mechanism was actually already in place to bring forward the deceit and lies that have plagued many of us since the beginning. Now, the illuminated ones, you might refer to them as Masons, Elks, Shriners, the Illuminati, Luciferians, Bilderbergs, Rothschilds, Rockefellers. I mean, I could call the roll. Bilderberg Group, you know, and there's many of them in the midst posing to be sincere for us. So I tell you to beware, brothers and sisters. They come as sheep. They come as wolves in sheep's clothing. There's many of you, these Moors, that's actually been invaded, and they're promoting a lot of madness. So, I mean, be careful of any kind of organization that you claim yourself to, because you thereby become a slave to that organization. You don't want to go from one slave plantation to another slave plantation. You don't want to do that, brothers and sisters. That would not be very wise, to go from one plantation to the next. So, our story begins with the original 13 colonies, so to speak, with the illuminated ones. Now, on May the 1st in 1776, as their day of birth in the United States of America, this statement was made in 1782, and I quote, "The nation that is now being formed, 200 years from now, will bring in one world government. The seat will be England. The very men who are given credit for the funding document in a large part, not all, sent here by King George through loans from him, or simply with the intent to once again let men think that they were free." You see the deception begin a long time ago. So when in reality, brothers and sisters, the country was already being prepared for the subjugation by the state. But six of the signers of the Declaration of Independence were actually dragged from their homes. Now, did you know this? Dragged from their homes in the middle of the night and brutally murdered. Six of them. And such is the price of freedom. So you guys talking about you want to be free. You want to be free. When you say you want to be a sovereign, in real truth, brothers and sisters, is a warrior. And if you're not ready to walk down that path or travel that road, don't use those words in your mouth. This is not for cowards. Nevertheless, so what we know is the Constitution was written and presented to the colonies as a declaration. Now, do you understand what a declaration is, brothers and sisters? A declaration cannot be amended. Declarations are not amended. It's nonsense. The British Accredited Regency, that you know as the Bar, and I'm talking about the one that's located right here in New York City, or New Babylon, whatever you may want to refer to it as, it makes it easy to argue change or amend. Now, the people were taught to change it from the Constitution back to the Declaration and vice versa. Now, there was originally 18 copies of the original. 18 copies. But each was actually located in the archives of law libraries. The libraries were actually burned to the ground.
because they didn't want you to know this information about the declaration. And this practice continued throughout the Civil War and then stopped. So in 1871, the DC Corporation was formed outside of the Constitution and put into operation. Many of you might have heard about the DC Corporation. Then, through money, manipulation in the early 1900s, especially 1913, with the passage of the Federal Reserve Bank Act, which is actually a private banking system. It's a private banking system, which was actually created. It created a central bank for the nation. And these men worked behind the scene in trickery. You know, like the Wizard of Oz. Like the Wizard. You've seen that movie, The Wizard of Oz. This whole thing is very similar. So they worked behind in trickery. So in 1929, the crash of the stock market, by draining the money out of the system and subsequently the Great Depression occurred. So now with the election of Franklin Delano Roosevelt, that one that many of you so love, you obviously don't know the truth about this man, and that in March the 9th, 1933, the Trading with the Enemy Act was part of this deceit and lies came into being. So when the government took all the gold from the people and made it a crime to own his gold or to hoard gold, the people of the United States lost their money. And many of you today telling me, why do I do an A for V? Why don't I just pay it back? And you're a hypocrite. You make me sick to my stomach with that. Government made it a crime to hold and harbor the gold that the people own. They took the people's money away. So the Americans lost their money and their ability to pay debt. So now you can't pay debts. You can only discharge them. You cannot cancel out a debt or pay a debt with a promissory note. A promissory note is a promise to pay. You cannot pay a debt with another debt. So the people are unable to pay their debts with money. So what they did is basically, he who owns the gold rules. And government has the gold and establishes law. Now they establish statutes and so on and so forth, and they call them law. Now, at this time, the government declared all property in the United States as belonging to the government and was made to be used for the government. You could like it, understand it, believe it or not, but I'm speaking truth to you. Now, they were speaking in a federal sense, brothers and sisters, and the people thought that they was talking about the 48 states. Now, only the federal government went bankrupt, not the 48 states. The federal corporation was now brought under the covers of everyone, and they was convinced that the answer was here. And I'll continue this on in the next video. Shalom. Shalom, brothers and sisters. Once again, it's the voice of Brother Tazadaq. For the record, I'd like to reserve my rights according to the Bill of Rights and the Constitution. This is not legal advice. I do not offer legal advice. This is for entertainment, educational, informational purposes only. If you need legal advice, seek yourself a competent attorney and please be advised. Let's continue on. Let's talk about the redemption process and how the wool was actually pulled over our eyes. So the deceit actually presented to the American people was now in full force. The governors of the 48 states, the United States, all gathered at a meeting with the birth certificates of all citizens of their state in hand and pledged the energy behind the stocks and bonds and notes created by the federal government.
who actually then sold them to the Federal Reserve, at the same time placed the dollar of the Federal Reserve note to ensure the payment of the stocks, bonds, and notes. Now, what's the problem with that? The problem was the people could not pay a debt. The people could not pay a debt. With a debt, the Federal Reserve notes with permissions or actually consent by the accent of the people. Now, the deceit was, how do you get people to consent to put a debt instrument against their own property and access? Now, how would they do it? By creating democracy. And you say, I'm a Democrat. Now, what you are, you're a damn fool. Mob rule is democracy. Democracy is actually the rule of the devil when you look up the etymology of the word, but I'm not going to go into that. So by creating a democracy form of government, in simple terms, is actually nothing more than commercial, corporate, and contract form of government. That's what democracy is. It's a commercial form of government, which actually cannot do anything but create debt. It creates debt. Then you can't take the Republican form of government away. So they had to have a way to pay their debts. So they passed House Joint Resolution 192. They passed that June 5th, 1933. And that took care of the matter. So the people were now to be ruled by public policy with House Joint Resolution 192, which is actually common law or anything that is established that the people will accept. So House Joint Resolution 192 or HJR 192 on June 5th, 1933 established public policy for what? For the money that the people now did not have. So the government would now pay the debts of the people dollar for dollar. Now, this would be done with what is known as credit. And only the people who could actually issue credit was the Federal Reserve banking system. Deceive. See, the people were to be given preferred stocks in the federal corporation. Now, the people was to be getting was to actually be given prepaid accounts in the Federal Reserve Corporation. And the people were the holders in due course of the Federal Reserve Corporation. And the people were to be exempt from levy. Do you understand what I'm saying? For those of you that really don't understand how this A for V thing works and that wants to complain about it, do you understand what I'm saying to you? So the people were to actually were actually created into corporations or corporate fictions or strawmen, whichever you like to use, through the birth certificate, through the social security numbers, and through the voting registration. Now, these fictions, the stocks, notes, bonds, were actually created. So the credit to pay the debts would actually be established by the signature of the people. I'm going to say that again. The credit to pay the debts would actually be created by the signature of the people. Money created out of thin air. The bank, brothers and sisters, let me tell you something. You go and you apply for a loan. Let me wake you up to something. And I don't give a damn how what public official don't like this for entertainment purposes. I'm going to entertain you and I'm going to educate as many people that needs to be educated that I possibly can. So the bank, brothers and sisters, and this is real truth, the bank never loans money. You go and you get your car. You go and you get your house and you say, I got a loan. The bank never loans money, only credit. You got to get that through your school. The bank never loans money. The bank never loans money, only credit. The bank never loans money, only credit. The bank never loans money, only credit. Since the Federal Reserve notes.
are a debt note. That's why I say this. They are actually a liability to the Federal Reserve banks. Do you follow me? So the deceit of the Federal Reserve Bank and their agents, all corporations, by the way, only a corporation creates debt, brothers and sisters. It is a fiction. It is an illusion. It is actually to get the people to allow them to place the Federal Reserve notes against their assets without directly saying, for it is a felony. It's a felony, brothers and sisters, for anyone to actually request or accept Federal Reserve notes and payment of a debt. You cannot pay a debt with a debt. So when they tell you, you pay this in Federal Reserve note or else, brothers and sisters, that's a felony. You can't pay a debt with a debt. How can they tell you to pay a debt, with a debt? So with the passage of the Social Security Act, brothers and sisters, the real deceit began. The real deceit began then, because the federal government would now take care of you from the cradle to the grave. So you thought. So the Social Security Administration was created as a trust. So the people apply for a Social Security card. Or in Canada, Social Insurance Number. SIN. Social Insurance Number. SIN. You're all sinners. Here they just call it a Social Security card. In Canada, it's a Social Insurance Number. It made you all sinners. Do you follow what I'm saying? So the people apply for a Social Security card. And the Social Security Administration, as the grantor, establish each person as a trust. Or a fiction. Or a corporation. The name in all capital letters. Such as John Doe in all capital letters. And it is actually placed into the trust. With the natural person, John Doe, all the trusts or corporations report to the Internal Revenue Service through a form 1040. One. Now, we are the trustees, brothers and sisters. Now, we were told that we're supposed to file a form 1040. Now, I know they don't want this to get out, but to hell with it. I'm going to put it out. We was told that we're supposed to file a form 1040. That's the wrong form, brothers and sisters. For entertainment purposes, for educational purposes. You know, you're told that you're supposed to file a form 1040 as a federal employee and are to actually be charged income tax. Now, we should be filing a form 1041. And no tax is paid or owed. Remember, we are tax exempt. We're exempt from levy. Now, all of the people were now held by power of attorney in the bar. To those of you that don't understand. So, in or about 1938, Erie Railroad versus Tompkins changed the American justice system forever. Simply stated, without contract, there is no case. Contract becomes the sole basis in every federal corporation system and court system. And I'm going to continue on in the next video. Shalom. Shalom, brothers and sisters. Once again, it's the voice of Brother Tazadaq. Coming at you through the Spirit of the Most High in Christ. This is not legal advice. I do not offer legal advice. This is for entertainment, educational, informational purposes only. If you need legal advice, seek yourself a competent attorney and please be advised. For the record, I would like to reserve my right. I'm going to continue on. I was talking about redemption and how this whole thing went down and how the deceit and war was actually pulled over our eyes. So in or about 1938, Erie Railroad versus Tompkins changed the American justice system basically forever. Simply stated, without contract, there is no case. Cases equals actually contract. Contract became the sole basis, brothers and sisters, in the federal corporation systems and the court system. So the federal government is commercial. and they deal in contract. Contract, contract, contract. All cases in courts are viewed as contract. Now, you can like or understand it, believe it or not. But if you go in and argue the merit of the case, you're going to lose. Argue the contract. Is there a contract? Is there a contract in place? If they don't have a contract with you, they have nothing against you. There must be some kind of contract. Did you contract with them? If you go in, then you argue the contract. Or get a contract. Contract, contract, contract. So in or about 1939, the Bar Act was established in all the states, and all attorneys, esquires, lawyers, counselors had to join the bar and actually get a number in order to practice before the courts. Brothers and sisters, they do not, they will lie and tell you that they have a license to practice law. You're damn, you know, they're liars. You don't have a license to practice law. They do not have a license to practice law. For actually to do so would actually be to subject them to the state, given the license. So they don't have a license to practice law. The state government is the only one who could actually license, not the bar or the Supreme Court of the various states. An attorney lies when he or she tell you that they have a license to practice law, for they're lying to you. That document hanging on their wall says certificate. Certificate, not a license. So, nevertheless, in 1946, the monumental change came about with the entire American system of government when the fourth branch of government was established with the passage of the Federal Administrative Act. And every corporation, which actually now includes cities, towns, schools, districts, etc., now sits its actually own rules, regulations, codes, statutes, and procedures. That changed everything, brothers and sisters. So as these rules, regulations, codes, statutes, procedures are not law, they can actually change at the whim of administrators of the agency. Now this is sick. So as long as they do not violate the Constitution of the United States, they could change it. And these are simply bar rules, regulations, codes, statutes, procedures. Since the president of the Bar of New York has signed off on all of these rules, regulations, codes, and statutes and procedures since 1926. And this is how this thing has been going down. So in or around 1970, 71, 72, and 73, everything changed in the court system. The court system changed, brothers. The change and the intent came together, and a person could actually no longer plead innocent because they had to prove that he did not intend to do something, which is actually impossible. You could actually now only plead guilty, not guilty, or no contest. And that's crazy. That's crazy. In these administrative courts, an admiralty court, and silver meaning commercial or contract. So we are brought into the court, and when we plead, we have admitted that we understand the charge that comes down upon us. So the people can never have a charge brought against them, only in a claim. But the instant that you say guilty, not guilty, or no contest, you accept the charge, brothers and sisters. So our court systems, our courts are common law, and our law is established in every county you live in. And the county is actually the seat of government. So you establish your case through affidavit, and you enter them into the county record. And that becomes public policy concerning your case. and you wait 30 days, and if the affidavit is rebutted, you enter a default into the county records. And then you make out an order for the county judge, and you have him or her enforce your judgment. Now, that's how you handle this thing. So the government officials are called constitutors, which means anyone who swears an oath to pay the debt of another. So the government has been actually putting their obligation to pay the debt back on us, back on we, the people. Thereby, the acceptance for value. You understand what I just said to you? You might want to play that part of the video back and listen to that again. Turn that back. Listen to that again. So, brothers and sisters, that's how this thing is going down. That's how the game is being played. And you need to understand how this thing is going down. So, emergency rule. So, October the 6th, 1917, Woodrow Wilson submit to Congress and passes the Trading with Enemy Act, an act to define and regulate and punish with the enemy and for the purpose. Congress, with this act, defined who was to be considered the enemy. And this act gave the government the total authority over these individuals to do with what it saw fit. And the enemy is we, the people. So again, my name is Brother Tazadaq. Say shalom.